the nature and, as it were, the science of interconnectedness in a rather hackneyed way, the issue of the butterfly flapping its wings in China and we end up in a hurricane in wherever in South Africa. This, I think, narrowing it down to a set of cause and effect, probabilistic, statistical states and so on. But if you conceive of these worlds, of these universes, as all merely reflections of, and illusory reflections of the unipolar reality, there is still is the element of interconnectedness that makes all of these relationships possible and actualizes them. In the tradition of Islam, it's called barzakh, the interspace, the intermediate space, the connecting thread, the relational thread. But it is where the world of af'al, of actions, it is a universe where various realities interconnect in a way that is very difficult to articulate, but as if it has infinite axes and infinite occurrences in time and space. It's as if we have the Big Bang and the steady state at the same time.
Correct.
So this science, as it were, which I'm sure has its own laws of interconnectedness, the science of Barzakhia, knowledge of that seems to be critical to actualizing what you have just outlined. That for the limited to understand that it is limited and to acknowledge it and to accept its withering away as greater knowledge becomes more and more established, requires a knowledge also of the interconnectedness of things. This barzakhia, which has manifested itself in infinite forms, some of them we know, some of them have been structured in models of the universe, of the spiritual universe, of the unseen and so on. Would you say that this is a fundamental aspect of understanding, understanding the knowledge of the absolute?
Except that I like to highlight something. I live in a situation where time and space matters, and I'm limited by them, and I'm defined in my actions and in my thoughts and in my knowledges by them. Once you enter into the other zone, then there is a very rapid, accelerated, if you like, diffusion of this business of space and time. Therefore, I would also say, I would like to highlight this, that what we consider this knowledge that has to be cumulative is no longer once you are in that barzakh state. Here, the more knowledge I have, the more knowledge I have. In the barzakh, in this no man's land state, the less I have, the more, the quicker I will experience it. So knowledge becomes an experience and a taste. That's why this word dhawq had been used, you know, extensively. You will taste something else. Then you find everything else is of very low significance compared to it. You've tasted something that is of immense joy or bliss or ease that you cannot describe. It's no longer comfort, it's no longer ease, it's no longer any of the pleasures. It is another zone. And the requirement of that barzakhiyya is to come to it with humbleness, to come to it without baggage, without carrying what I have learned in this first zone. Because this has been my life, my crutch, my biography, my... But that's why the Quran also says you cannot touch it if you come to it unless you have got a pure heart. That means no expectation, you just give up. You have no assumption or presumption. You can't approach it with a man of knowledge. You can't approach it with a man of piety. You cannot approach it with a man of sincerity. All of these you have left behind. You know, you have practiced all of those, but when you come to that ocean, you have to jump, if you like, naked with nothing. And then it will be another zone of space or time. You know, so to us it may appear a second. The Quran also alludes to that. The time becomes relative. One day, that zone is like 1,000 years as you count, or one period or one day is like 50,000 years as you count, and. So here I am judging everything through what I've learned, and it's helped me to survive. It's helped me to